Well, John and I met and decided that I would go first and talk about some of the basic political issues that are changing in Topeka. And then he would comment on some of those issues and give you a better sense of the process and how citizens could get involved. I mean, this is a battle, this is a war that we're in as to what's happening with the tone and tenor of Kansas legislature and the governor's office, and they need all the help we can get to find some more moderate and progressive candidates at this point. Is something in control, though?
Yeah.
That'd be great. I'll just tell you if you pass it to him. Folks, I've been lobbying 30 years, and it's hard to overstate just how conservative and how much of a right-wing turn this state took with our current governor. So, and he came to the office with three or four specific changes in mind. One, he wants to reduce government spending. And quite honestly, it's basically reduce government spending. You get the revenues down, and then programs suffer after that. We're not talking about a kind of a balance of what's adequate funding for government programs in the state of Kansas. It really gets down to, we're going to drown this government in a bathtub, as Grover Norquist would say. And that's what's starting to happen in our state at this point. Alter judicial selections. He was able to reach in and change the statute in our state about the selection of Kansas Court of Appeals judges. To be able to do that for the Kansas Supreme Court, you're going to have to change the Constitution at this point to be able to do it. And we'll get to this. They don't have enough votes right now in the House. But probably most importantly, to eliminate the income tax in the state of Kansas. With, in 2012, with the financial assistance of a few conservative political action groups, several moderate state senators were targeted. So now we're sitting at 32 Republicans, 8 Democrats in our 40-member state senate, and at least 28 of them are very hardcore conservative members. In the House, you have 92 Republicans and 33 Democrats at this point. And a lot of people think that we have about 25 or 26 of those Republicans are still in what you call the moderate camp at this point. They joined together to defeat the constitutional amendment effort to change our selection of our Kansas Supreme Court. So 2014 is a key election year for the governor, attorney general, secretary of state, U.S. senator, 4 congressional seats, and all 125 members of the Kansas House. And with the redistricting that went down in 2012 in our state, there was some really radical changes in the membership of our Kansas House. So we had 42 brand new people brought in 2012, and in 2010 there were about 25 brand new folks. So out of 125 members, well over half of them are serving their first or second term at this point. I think the political question going forward for 2014 is, How hard will the conservative political action forces in this state try and take out the 25 or 26 moderate Kansas House Republicans that are left? For the last 25 years, Kansas has had a pretty balanced tax policy between income sales and property taxes. And you can read these numbers, property tax about 34% in 2012. Sales tax accounted for 28%, income taxes for 24%. Legislation was passed to significantly lower individual income taxes by 2017. Partially pay for this reduction, our state sales tax was kept at 6.15 instead of falling back to 5.7 as was promised in 2012. Income taxes are our most progressive taxation we have in the state. Sales taxes are the most aggressive, and property taxes are somewhere in the middle of that. And you can read the comment here about the governor's tax equity task force really concluded that state and local taxes should be balanced and diversified. A diversified tax system offer a blend of economic trade-offs, and because all revenue sources have their weaknesses, a balanced tax system will reduce the magnitude of problems caused by over-reliance on a single tax source. So besides on a glide path to eliminate the individual income tax, the governor went with a proposal to eliminate income taxes all at once, starting in 2013, for 191,000 sole proprietorships, subchapter S corporations, and limited liability corporations. We're the first state in the country to make this kind of dramatic change, and we're really not going to know the full impact of this until 2014 at the earliest. It's costing us $180 million a year to make this change. And there's no tracking system on these new corporations, so that we're not going to know if we're bringing in new entities into the state as a recruiting tool, which is what the governor wanted, or whether we're going to just watch all of our single businesses, the veterinarians, accountants, attorneys, whatever, incorporate to stop paying income taxes. You can see that our estimated revenue Kansas is already starting to fall at this point. From November 2012 to this November 2013, income taxes have fallen 19%, or $221 million. The belief by the governor was that these income tax deductions will generate significant new economic development, thus replacing the lost revenue. He patterned this after 10 states that don't have an income tax in the United States, but they have oil, they have coal, they have tourism, they have a whole other broad array of taxing sources that Kansas doesn't have. And we're one of only six states now that has a full sales tax on groceries. About a third of all our sales tax comes out of from groceries. The belief is that to offset this loss in income taxes, we're going to have to see 8 to 10% growth in sales tax to make up for it. And from last November to this November, our sales tax actually went down 3%, or $28 million. A key decision will be made next April when our consensus revenue estimators get together and make a decision about what the revenue picture looks for the next 18 months going forward. So here's the budgetary challenges that the Governor Brownback walked into office with. I mean, Sebelius and Parkinson had no choice but to make significant cuts when the recession of 2009 hit in this country. So we cut K through 12 by 7%. We reduced reduced regions by 7, K through 12, 14%, and corrections budget went down 18%. The governor basically locked those reductions into place with his budgets, and then while cutting income taxes, even further cuts into K through 12 education. And you can see that the number of state employees that have dropped a couple thousand since he's taken office. I guess the editorial comment here is that we're past the point of even asking whether we have enough employees to do the proper jobs in our state at this point. It's really, we're just going to get headcount down, and whatever they can do, they'll do. For the 2014 Kansas budget, that runs from July 1st, 2013 to June 30th, 2014, we have a budget of $14.5 billion. Your share of it's $4,845 per Kansan. Within this budget, it's a little tricky to say, but it's the key thing that the state legislature really works on is what's called the State General Fund. And the State General Fund then is the funding mechanism to draw either federal and other monies into the state. And as you can see, for the State General Fund, 49% of that income comes from income, and 41% comes from sales tax. So if you take that 49% out of funding our State General Fund, you're creating significant holes unless that sales tax jumps significantly. You can read the numbers here. We spend 43% on education, 13% on Medicaid, then we call KanCare, 12% highways, 11% state hospitals, etc. For those of you who are really interested in all this, up on the Kansas Legislative Research Department's website, this is probably the best analysis. It's called Kansas Fiscal Facts, the 20th edition. This is your best overview of the state budget.
Who makes that?
What?
That's from the nonpartisan Kansas Legislative Research Department. So, and they have PDFs as well as printed copies at the Capitol.
So going forward, one of the key questions is what's going to happen to K-12 public education funding in the state of Kansas? And it looks, the best guess is that by January or February 2014, the Kansas Supreme Court will come back with a decision about whether the state legislature has to increase the funding that it is giving to K-12 at this point. The state of Kansas, the folks who argued the case said that Kansas Supreme Court should not have the right to force expenditures from the Kansas legislature, but our state constitution mandates funding for a suitable education. So a lot of lawyers can disagree or argue about where the authority lies at this point. 2014, most of you here in KU know that we decreased funding for the Board of Regents and post-secondary education by 3%, $23 million. The governor wants to restore that. The governor vetoed the 2015 Department of Corrections and Facilities budget. This is all our prisons, et cetera, because he thought the 2015 budget was too low. But so we're going to find more money for that, and I think there'll be discussion on private prisons. This is probably the really key element. If conservatives are able to take over the Kansas House, this is probably a certainty of what's going to happen going forward in our state. In essence, what's going to happen is that we're going to lock down any revenue increase annually to the state of Kansas by no more than 2%. Anything over 2% will go to the complete elimination of first individual and then corporate income taxes at this point. That would lock in the underfunding of so many of our critical programs at this point. We've completely privatized the Medicaid program now. It's called KanCare. And our best hope for that is restricting the growth in this program. We are not going to step in and cut Medicaid spending at this point, but it's just that we're going to slow that growth at this point. And not all programs are equal here. I guess that's in essence what I want to say, is that K-12 education and then what we have to spend on Medicaid will be the driving forces in what's available for revenues for everything else that we do, senior meals, public health, environmental monitoring, etc. I mean, all of these, we could spend a long time on. Temporary assistance for families is our basic welfare program for the poorest mothers and children in our state. The governor came to office promising that one of his five key goals was to reduce childhood poverty. This program particularly deals with the poorest children that we have in the state. We've not raised the cash grant that these poor families get since 1996, so the value of the cash grant that people are getting is a third less than it was. We've now instituted a 28-hour-a-week work requirement if you're going to get child care assistance. We want people working, but for many part-time jobs, Walmart jobs, etc., they can't control 28 hours necessary to get it to be able to hold on their child care assistance. Kansas now decided that for mothers giving birth in the state of Kansas, you can stay home for 2 months, and then you've got to get back to job training or work at this point. We're the only state in the country that has taken this from 6 or a year down to 2 months to it. And you can see we've almost cut the half caseload in half in 3 years, number of children that have fallen off assistance, and there's been no public input or legislative oversight of these policy changes that have been made with that. I get a long spiel about corporate agriculture and what's happening with that. Kansas is one of 6 or 8 states, there's one of 8 states in the country that has restrictions on corporations buying land in our state. The governor's proposed complete elimination to allow land speculation, to allow even larger compliant animal factories. water issues are really a big deal. The drought really forced that debate in the state of Kansas. We've got about 7 or 9 federal reservoirs in the eastern half part of the state that supply 2/3 of the drinking water for our cities and customers, and they're silting in. They're dying, and that capacity is lowering. Now we're talking about pumping Missouri water 300 miles to western Kansas at the cost of $10 or $15 billion. And finally, there's a whole debate about we're going to have to dredge John Redmond Reservoir because it's the backup cooling facility for the Wolf Creek Nuclear Power Plant, and that will be tens of millions of dollars to be spent. Lastly, there'll be a whole debate, I do this with the League of Women Voters, on voter registration. There's really a real debate about proof of citizenship and whether that's required, you know, what you can do to require that. And you can have a voter ID to be able to vote in Kansas, and that particularly affects women who are divorced and change their name back to, you know, I mean, you get into technical glitches on the basic right to vote at this point. I'm sure I'm taking my time. I'll let John pick up at this.
Thank you for that uplifting message. That's the good news. I mean, all joking aside, at my table I was having a conversation about how do I make it through a legislative session where it seems like every policy being passed is antithetical to my core values as a person, as a human being in this world, or as a Christian. And it's very tough. And the reality is, quite honestly, that there's a lot of bad policy making happening, and unfortunately, that some of that's going to stick around for a while and have lasting effects. But as we've seen in the past, if you get too heavy-handed in your policy making, and you get too confident in what you think the will of the people is, that backfires, and there are different political outcomes to the bad policy outcomes. And I have to say that from my perspective, I think that we will see some different political outcomes if this trend continues from what Paul was sharing, and if people, reasonable people, get out and not only vote, but also put pressure on those people who are making decisions in the state house. So I want to spend a little bit of time talking about some of the political realities of the process, the political process at the Capitol. And then I also want to spend a little bit of time about what we all can continue to do as citizens, as people who care about issues, to make a difference. Because I really don't want everybody to leave this talk feeling depressed and feeling like there's no solutions to this problem. But keep in mind, it's not going to be easy, and it's going to take hard work, it's going to take money, it's going to take time. And you would just need to figure out what of those pieces you can contribute. I want to add a little bit of color commentary onto some of the things that Paul said. And I have to say, that's an outstanding summary. And whoever retains him for lobbying services is getting an excellent value. I should say that he is a testament to the fact that lobbyists are an important part of the process in the Capitol. It really comes down to what are the issues that you're standing up for. Know that it's easy to broad brush every lobbyist as greedy and evil. But they have been an incredible help to me in a number of areas, whether talking about farming or the environment or women's health, a number of other issues, education. So keep that in mind. But I want to say the governor's tax plan, this tax experiment. If you're like me, fiscal policy is not maybe your strong suit. As Phil mentioned, my background's in design, so I have to think about problems a little bit differently. He mentioned that our income tax is the most progressive form of tax, and sales tax is the most regressive. In case you're not aware of it, what that simply means is sales tax hurts poor and working families more than it hurts wealthier individuals. Here's an example. If you make $10,000 a year and have to go buy a gallon of milk, you pay the same tax as somebody who makes $10 million a year on that gallon of milk. The challenge a person who is a working poor and barely making it is they have to spend the majority of their income. They can't save it. They can't invest it in the same ways that people on the wealthier end of the spectrum can. So therefore, they're hit more by sales tax. And when you think about a percentage of your income is also going, a huge percentage is going towards food, and we still tax the sale of food, then that's just kind of double whammy. And after some fighting, we were actually able to reinstate the food sales tax rebate program that was originally cut under the governor's plan. So the poorest of families could apply for a tax rebate on the food sales tax they paid. We had to fight to get that back. So I just want to make sure you all understand that. There seems to be this deliberate disregard for the people who are just barely making it and not even making it in the state of Kansas. And you can see that in tax policy, you can see that in our education policy, and you can see that, I would even say, in our environmental policy, when you think about our energy choices, and you think about the effects on our health that the environment has, and where the people who are most vulnerable live, and the types of environmental conditions they're in, it's just really tragic. And part of my role on the Children and Seniors Committee is to really put a spotlight on how these issues are affecting children and young people in the state. And I'll tell you, that's one of my big goals for this upcoming session. Now that I kind of know the lay of the land, that's going to be one of my top priorities, is really putting some pressure on the Department of Children and Families to figure out what's their logic behind these kind of secretive regulation changes. I'm gonna pivot a little bit because I want to make sure we have time also to just answer your questions that you have. But is everybody familiar generally with how bills become laws in the state? You know, you have the House and you have the Senate, and then you have the executive branch, you have the judicial branch. I'll tell you that I thought it was just going to be a standard. That's how it all works. Somebody has a really logical idea, and it's backed up by facts, and then you share that with your committee, and then they're like, oh my gosh, that's a really terrific idea. We need to do this. Let's pass it because it's going to help people out. The reality is that's not quite how it works, sadly. And Senator Francisco knows that as well, more than I do. And I'll say, I came into my first session with pretty high expectations and probably unrealistic expectations that are changed for this upcoming session. But I'm not giving in. It's just I've got to tweak my tactics a little bit and temper my expectations. But let me tell you a little bit about how the process works. You heard the numbers in the Senate and the House. You also heard that, you know, of course, a conservative governor. We have a conservative governor. We have a conservative congressional delegation. We have a conservative Senate delegation. We have conservative-controlled statewide offices. So within the House and Senate, you usually